Hello, everyone. Great pleasure to be here. Again, I'd like to thank the organizers. I think this is a great event. Startups always runs a great seminars. What I thought today would be more of a conversation, you know, to kind of share my experience, but more or less, you know, have a dialogue between us and a little bit about myself. I'm 46 years old. I've been in Bulgaria for the last 19 years. I came directly after business school. I did an MBA at Kellogg in Northwestern University. Before that, I worked for Coopers and Lybrand and for Equitable. Equitable was a large financial company in the US. And ended up coming to Bulgaria really knowing nothing about the country. It was more of an internship program, but it was working with the Bulgarian American Enterprise Funds. And the Bulgarian American Enterprise Fund was, I think, the first investment fund in Bulgaria. It was a $55 million US government-sponsored funds. And the whole idea was, instead of, you know, giving government aid, it was more or less making investments. So very much like in a mini version of EBRD. Say the first, you know, we originally thought we were going to be venture capital and private equity. However, the first two investments went bankrupt in 1991 and 1992, and they were just startups. And you know, the key mistake there is, you know, you think if you have $55 million that, okay, now we're going to start building businesses. However, you build businesses around people. So, you know, what we ended up doing is we ended up focusing on doing smaller, risky, I would say, making loans, because primarily in the early 90s, the private equity environment in Bulgaria was not really ready for venture capital. So what we did was high-yielding loans, which were quasi-equity-type loans. We started small, worked with the entrepreneurs, we continued to build our exposure, and on a case-by-case basis, we would do some private equity investments, but it would be kind of smaller investments than initially thought. You know, step-by-step, we ended up doing so many loans that we took the loans and created a bank called the Bulgarian American Credit Bank, which we ended up doing a listing on the stock exchange and ended up selling the bank to Allied Irish Bank. So the total investment of the Bulgarian American Credit Bank initially was approximately $9 million, but in total it was sold for over 400 million euros. You know, was the effective price that it was exited at. However, you know, not too long ago, that same bank was sold for 100,000 euros to new investors. So I think our timing was right, because we had been there a long time. But we ended up doing in Bulgaria just many, mainly I would say quasi-equity type lending, but we've worked with many companies such as, you know, Devon Mineral Water, Royal Cake, Darko Ice Cream, you know, Sanita Pharmaceuticals, Happy Barn Grill, you know, many of the Bulgarian brands that have really become more and more established over the years. So, you know, we've ended up working with them. In about, I would say, about maybe in 2005, I started the Balkan Accession Fund, which was a mezzanine private equity fund for the Balkans. So the idea was to work with Bulgarian companies and work with companies in the region and help them expand throughout the region. Additionally, I ended up doing quite a bit of, I would say, angel investments. So I invested in companies like EasySoft, which is the owner of Moite Paris, which is one of the sponsors here. They're the owner of Creditland. It's a financial comparison portal. I ended up financing the team for JobTiger, which is a portal for an HR service. For recruitment, ended up doing Club 50 Plus, which is a company to empower seniors over 50. So in general, worked with Zadružno, an investor in Zadružno, a group buying portal. In addition, you know, one of the things we did at the Bulgarian American Enterprise Fund is we organized a competition for young entrepreneurs. So I was managing that for several years. Actually, for the 12 years I was there, but when I had left, there was a need to, you know, in the market to continue the program, and the Enterprise Fund had a 15-year life, so it was coming to an end. So we ended up creating a foundation and started the Empower Awards, a public-private partnership. So I consider myself more of an investor and an entrepreneur. Because you know, when you're an investor, you want to be an entrepreneur, and when you're an entrepreneur, you want to be an investor. So I thought today would just more or less to kind of share any questions and open it up. You know, I could give you like the advices I have, you know, as an entrepreneur, when I'm looking, trying to, you know, consider opportunities, I just look for problems. And it's everything that we were talking about here earlier. You know, what is the problem you're trying to solve? And if that problem isn't big enough, you know, then you've got to move on. So maybe we should just open it up. I'd like to more or less have a conversation today, as opposed to just me kind of talking continuously. Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the VC environment in Bulgaria compared to Europe or the States?
Well, I can tell you, I think the VC environment has significantly changed. And it's, in the early 90s, doing like venture capital investments was very difficult, if not impossible, in Bulgaria because, many of the companies were avoiding taxes, so there was two sets of books. There was also, this was before the internet really developed, so there were, the idea that you'd be able to build a company that could compete internationally, the entrepreneurs did not really, that was not something that they could envision. I can tell you, when I first got here, I spent, literally years traveling to, throughout Bulgaria to the different towns and cities, talking to entrepreneurs, and it was difficult. I mean, there was lots of entrepreneurs that had a business card saying, I am CEO, but there was no real business behind it. Most of the companies were estate companies. So, it was one of the big issues is trying how to do, real business with real entrepreneurs. It is developed, it's unbelievable the changes that have taken place. But the changes that have taken place in Bulgaria are the same changes that are taking place throughout the world. So, right now, things are changing so fast. Like, if you look at one business model, we're in shareholder in Zadružno. Well, there's probably over 70 sites that do the Groupon model in Bulgaria alone. So, from the time that a new business model breaks out, thousands of entrepreneurs throughout the world are almost replicating immediately that same idea. So it's getting harder and harder to really come up with something proprietary. I think one of the things that the government is doing is, these Jeremy funds, I think, will be very successful because this is what's needed in Bulgaria. This is what has been needed for a long time, the early stage. Because, in my experience is there's lots of bigger funds. They're all looking for well-established companies, but there are literally no funds that would do, a startup for just an idea. And, that is coming, and it's coming relatively quickly. And, the whole idea is, like Lugo spoke about this ecosystem. If you don't have the full ecosystem, you're in big trouble because, if you started, the biggest problem with startups is they run out of money. And if it's a big idea, you've got to invest quickly. And if it's a great idea and you're not investing, someone's going to replicate the idea with a lot more money. There's got to be more questions here. Yeah. Yeah. Question.
You mentioned that there is a change on the market since you came to Bulgaria. But my question to you is the change coming from people who went abroad to the West, the USA, for example, studied there, worked there, succeeded there, they came back, and they did the change themselves, or is the change coming from if you have access to academia in Bulgaria for the last time you've been here, is the success coming from the educational system in Bulgaria?
I think the change is coming from the internet. I mean, I just asked how many people here read TechCrunch? Yeah, I mean, many entrepreneurs, almost all entrepreneurs, were in TechCrunch, VentureBeat, and maybe, you know, five or six others. So we're all reading the same business models. We all say, wow, look at what they just did here. We could do this. Maybe we could add this to it. You know, it's the internet is making the world so small. And that's why, you know, a company like Groupon, how could a company that's only a few years old be worth billions? How could Facebook be all over the world? Google be all over the world? So, you know, it's a winner-take-all, like, you know, environment. And that's why, you know, so many of the exits in Silicon Valley and in the US and actually throughout the world, they're to more of the established players as opposed to continuing to grow the company organically.
Just to follow up very quickly, but the culture of a society, make the face of a human being. The culture reflects the identity of a human being. If you don't have the culture of market, of open market, or if you are not educated in seeing new business horizons, creating business, how can you do it? You said it yourself at the very beginning.
The culture is, I mean, it's here. Like, this event is an evidence of it. And this didn't exist like in the early 90s, such events. And this is not organized by the government. It's not organized by foreign investors or foreign aid or whatnot. This is organized by the students, actually. So, you know, the world is getting smaller and smaller. Every place in the world, like major cities, they're having events like this. You know, 7 billion people in the world. You multiply the amount of startups that are happening almost every day. You know, it's almost beyond imagination. Yeah.
Въпросът ми е, защо решихте да инвестирате в...
Не, не, няма проблем, аз мога да се правя да но...
Защо решихте да инвестирате в България, при положение, че Великобритания има много по-голям потенциал, много по-голяма и опции за реализация? И какво видяхте в нашата страна, да инвестирате тук?
For me, I came right after, in the early 90s, right after business school, and it was a one-year program. So I viewed this, you know, as really as another year of my MBA. And that's the way life ends up working out. I never planned to stay here for so many years, but I always enjoyed it, and it's always been a challenge. So, you know, this might sound ridiculous or funny, but my thinking is, okay, you know, anybody could be successful in the States, but to be successful in Bulgaria is quite another thing, especially at that time. So it was really, you know, for me, it was an adventure to come to Bulgaria. Also, I was 26 years old, you know, so I had a very good position in a well-established private equity venture fund, the Bulgarian American Enterprise Fund. And, you know, I can tell you, coming out of business school to get such a job in investment funds in the U.S. was really not possible. So, you know, I think in Bulgaria, the potential is just enormous. It does not take a lot of people to develop very successful businesses. And, you know, I think Lubo's business is just a perfect example. You know, with an idea and a small team, step by step, he built something magnificent. And there are some, you know, I would say at least 20 examples of companies that compete on a, you know, a world level in Bulgaria that a lot of these companies you probably don't even know about. But they do exist, and they'll exist more. So, you know, the opportunity is here. The world's getting smaller, but definitely there is a real talent in Bulgaria for, I think, developing IT startups.
Hi, I want to ask, since you said you invest a lot, which is great in our country right now, but could you give us an example of an investment that you have done in our country that you consider a successful business model in my country?
In what's it?
A successful business model in Bulgaria that you have invested in, and why you consider it successful, exactly for what reasons you were investing in it.
Well, I think the most successful investment we had was the Bulgarian American Credit Bank. And it was investing in companies that other banks were not investing in. And if you're doing that, all entrepreneurs all love, you know, they never want to dilute shares in their company. Because for an entrepreneur, every company is, you know, their company is worth at least $1 billion. So, you know, as an entrepreneur, by definition, you are kind of a crazy, irrational person. And I could say this because I'm also an entrepreneur. But sometimes, you know, you judge the world. So entrepreneurs would prefer to get a loan for a higher percentage of interest because it's much cheaper than giving up equity in the company, or it can be. So, you know, our business model was between equity and between a typical secured bank lending. So I think that's still a very viable business model. And, you know, I think, you know, the financial crisis is really, it's changed all of banking. So banks have, you know, almost all banks have really taken a step back. But I think that model still could be replicated today. You know, there's really, I don't see any impediment to any business model starting in Bulgaria. I think, you know, one of the things with all of these group buying portals is, you know, there's a lot of competition, but one of the good things is it's promoted buying online, so there's a lot more people that are comfortable with buying through their credit cards online, so it is coming. There's got to be more entrepreneurs out here.
Some other question? Lee? Well, there are any questions.
Yeah.
Or you
no.
Have... Wait, I can... Can I give you the microphone?
Can you name an industry that is kind of needed to be disrupted, like what you did with the gap between the with the bank.
I mean,
can you name something? I'm just this is interesting for me to know your opinion because I would love to
think of this. As far as like industries that need to be disrupted, I think, you know, one of the reasons like I invested in Moi Tipuri is, you know, financial services. Because money is the ultimate commodity. So, you know, to bring transparency to financial services, that was one of the motivations for entering into that. I think advertising is an industry. I think education, these are industries that will be disrupted. I think education throughout the world, you know, with 7 billion people, you just need a new model for educating people. But I cannot think of, you know, any industry right now that is not like dramatically being impacted. And I think that's a lot of this, you know, economic crisis throughout the world is, you know, yes, it's over borrowing or whatnot, but I think it's also investors trying to figure out where are things headed, because, you know, it's almost not predictable. Like 5-10 years from now, I don't think there's any industry that you could make, you know, maybe a few of the, you know, the natural resources and things like that, but most other industries are completely being changed.
Hi there. It was mentioned a couple of times here that it's very important founders to be founders for a successful investment, obviously, and for the investors. So can you think of a situation, or if you personally have such case, where the idea is perfect and the founder seems very strong, but as a person, he's just not likable? What do you do in such situation?
As an investor, or?
Yes.
You know, it going into investments like a partnership. So I would never invest in a company where, you know, you're a team. So if you don't like each other, you know, I wouldn't invest in that. But it's you know, it's, I haven't really run into such situations really. I mean, there's difficult people, but also you could learn from such people, because you definitely if everyone in the team has the same opinion or whatnot, it's not necessarily good. You need a lot of times arguments, but these are not arguments, they're more discussions. Because if you don't have these discussions, you know, as an entrepreneur, you need to have really good ideas, you need to have a lot of ideas. And if you have a lot of ideas, that means by definition you have a lot of bad ideas. So really controlling your ego, learning that, you know, 98% of my ideas, you know, are not as good as I think they are, that's a very humbling experience. I think probably one of the keys to success is really just managing the ego and realizing, you know, asking yourself day in, day out, am I being the person that I'm capable of being with every decision and every interaction you have? So it's a matter of really just focusing one thing at a time on what you're doing and, you know, recognizing that, yeah, we all have strengths, but we also have weaknesses. But you've got to also kind of compensate for those weaknesses.
Can I elaborate a bit more? Basically, you're saying that there is always a personal judgment on the part of the investor.
Well, it's everyone. Like it's the whole team. It's, you know, life is very short. It flies by. So do I want to spend, you know, because to develop a successful company, I think requires at least 10 years. You know, most of the investment funds are 7 years, which I don't think are long enough, but at least 10 years, because it's really, you know, between year 8 and 15, that's when most of the value is created. So do you want to spend like 10 to 15 years with someone that you don't like? No, I don't care how much money you give me, it's not worth it.
И как, по какъв начин успя да ви спъне от вашите начинания?
So regarding the legal system?
Yes, the legal system helping your think of creation and how try to stop your plans.
Yeah, you know, the legal system in banking is different because you very much depend on the legal system. But as an angel investor, if you've got to depend on the legal system, you know, you don't have anything. Do you know what I mean? It's so as an early stage angel investor, there's not much value in the company other than, you know, the intellectual ideas, the, you know, the software and things like that. But you have to document, you know, you need a shareholders agreement, articles of incorporation. There has to be an understanding, but the Bulgarian legal system, I don't think, is an impediment at all, like in my experience. You know, if you're suing each other, probably there's going to be almost no value there anyway, so even if you win your lawsuit, it doesn't matter because there's not a lot of value. But it's not an issue, and I think the Bulgarian legal system is, you know, the laws make sense. I think the, you know, the structure makes sense, but it's, you know, it hasn't been an issue. In banking, it's a different story because then you have to foreclose on properties, and, you know, there's all sorts of games that can happen. But you know, as an early stage investor, it hasn't been an impediment. Bulgarian laws are actually quite flexible for, you know, you could structure investments in quite win-win situations.
I would like to ask if you would like to share some of the mistakes that you have done in your early years as an inventor, or in the entrepreneurship field. Is there some of those mistakes that you think that right now are available for what you are?
The biggest mistakes, really, it's ego, it's overconfidence, it's, you know, as an investor slash entrepreneur, you see a company for what it could be, not for what it is. you're kind of thinking, you know, like the biggest mistakes I've had is really not basing day-to-day decisions based on reality, the way things really are, as opposed to the way things, you know, I wish they would be or I think they could be in a few years. So, you know, it's, we were in, we started a poultry operation and we overexpanded. We ended up privatizing a facility that was beyond the management capability of the team there. And we absolutely had to take over the project, and it took many years to develop. It ended up being successful, but it would have been much more successful if it was carefully planned out, making very rational, logical decisions on a, you know, day-to-day basis. So, you know, just overexpanding is, you know, you've got to get the house in order. So whatever you do, your finances have to be perfect. You've got to feel, before you can, you know, run, you've got to walk, and before you walk, you've got to crawl. So you've got to get things in shape. Make sure that you can do the business on, you know, supporting a few customers before you make big investments and expand and waste all sorts of money in advertising and equipment if you don't have all of the details worked out from, you know, one end to the other. So it's, you know, I think my mistakes have been more or less, you know, seeing opportunities, being overconfident, not questioning, you know, my judgment, making some assumptions, assuming that, you know, your management team is capable. I mean, as an investor, it's always, you know, you're investing in the management. And, you know, one of the mistakes that we made in the poultry business is, you know, the assumption that, yeah, how difficult could it be to grow chickens and, you know, to sell them in the market? Well, you know, the thing is, poultry is a commodity. So you're competing with some of the most, you know, capital-intensive, competitive companies in Brazil, the U.S., you know, throughout the world. So it's not a matter of growing chickens. It's a, you know, it's a matter of being able to sell them, you know, to grow them at the right cost so that you can compete internationally. If you can't compete, there's no business. So you could lose, you know, a million. You could go out of business in just a few months unless you're really, you've got things worked out to the fullest. The same, we've done the same, like, you know, it's a learning experience. The biggest mistakes also I've made is not to expand quickly enough. You know, lots of times if you're trying to grow a business organically, you prefer not to get investors and whatnot. But if you don't expand quickly enough, someone's going to jump in with a lot of money. So, you know, it all depends on the context, on the situation. You know, I keep on making these mistakes, so it's not as if, you know, but it's, yeah.
Presenters from Cisco are saying that the first step should be the finding the problem and the need. So what would be your advice towards young people who are currently in university or recently graduating to really find the problem and test it?
You know, I like investing in businesses that gets me excited. So, you know, you've got to ask, well, what are the problems I'm having? What are the problems my family are having? You know, and then what are the possible solutions? And then, you know, ask, you know, how big a problem is this? Is this a really big problem? And then also, it's got to be your problem. In other words, something that you're willing to get excited and spend 10, 15 years of solving that issue. So, you know, you've got to ask yourself, you know, are you waking up in the morning and you keep on thinking about the same problem and then go to bed at night? So, you know, is this something that you could really do? And I think, you know, you've got to, you know, the key to success, they say, is to know yourself. And, you know, when it is your problem, then you've got to go for it.
Ask you something.
Yeah.
I was wondering, what was your most risky investment that you have ever done, not only in Bulgaria but at all? The most risky investment. And of course, what happened after that?
Startups are always the most risky investments because, you know, but they're also the smallest investment. So, you know, by definition, if you lose, you don't lose a lot of money. Because, you know, doing a startup, you're going from what you think is just an idea, putting together a team, building a product, assuming that you'll be able to sell that product for more money than it costs. And there's big assumptions all along the way. So, you know, we've done an investment in biotechnology, and as it turns out, the European Union came out with rules against biotechnology, and, you know, we've done various startups that, you know, in different spheres that have, you know, you end up losing, but, you know, it's not, so that's the key, is as an angel investor, you don't want to invest too much money, you want to invest enough to get it up and going, and if it's going well, to, you know, put some more money into it, and then, of course, you know, the key as an angel investor is make sure you line up additional funding, because if a company is developing well, it might be a great company, but there's no additional investor, you know, if the investors are all looking for a minimum of, you know, 1 million euro investment, and the company you're investing in only needs 75,000, you know, you're in trouble. As an investor, if you don't invest it, it'll go out of business. And, you know, the stakes get bigger as an angel investor. So, unfortunately, in Bulgaria, there's not a big angel investment community, so there has not been the opportunity to syndicate these investments with other investors. However, with these new charity funds, I think that's definitely coming.
I was wondering what has been tougher for you, being an investor in Bulgaria or being an entrepreneur in Bulgaria, and if you had to choose one of the professions to practice in Bulgaria, which one would you choose?
It's a good question. I would say, you know, I've been more, well, you know, it's difficult because, you know, as I consider an investor an entrepreneur an investor, you know, also the timing of markets mean a huge amount. You know, like I said, we sold our bank right before, literally, like, the deal closed a few weeks before the Lehman Brothers issue. So, you know, everything we sold into that market, you know, 1996 and 97, Bulgaria effectively went bankrupt. So the assets of, you know, asset values were so low from 96, 97, all the way up to, you know, 2008, that, you know, everybody looked like Warren Buffett in Bulgaria during those years. Since then, it's really more difficult. I enjoy, I think, being an entrepreneur more, because you're really day-to-day involved in the businesses. I think also being an angel investor, you are like an entrepreneur, because it's not like, you know, you're making, you know, a private equity investment and you'll have a board meeting once every month or something like that. You're constantly talking to people. I don't think I answered the question, but I don't think I know the answer. Any more questions?
Well, I have a question.
Yeah. Okay.
So, what's the feeling to be an investment agent? Well, what's the feeling, the things that you're doing?
Yeah.
And what do they bring to you? Like, inner feeling?
Well, it depends on the company.
Well, no, okay, it's okay.
Yeah, I like investing in, you know, the reason I came to Bulgaria and stayed for so long was really, you know, I ended up working for the Bulgarian American Enterprise Fund, so just helping other people get their business up and going. So it's really just, you know, the idea of empowering people, and that's, you know, this Empower Award is the real, you know, the reason we started this. So it's not money, because you know money, you make money, you lose money and whatnot, but it's the idea of, you know, for me, my motivation in life is, you know, to become the best person that I'm capable of becoming. And that's a day-to-day thing. So it's, you know, I'm asking myself that every day, because you know, it's so much of the returns of an entrepreneur, it's very tangible. But the problem is you don't see it for 10 to 15 years. So, you know, if you start a business 10 to 15 years, if you're constantly making good progress and taking the right steps and using your strengths, complementing your weaknesses, you know, you will get the results. And if you're not, you won't get the results. So it's, you know, it's for me, it's the process of you know, self-actualization. And also helping empower people, that's the motivation.
What's the biggest disappointment from somebody that you have messages? Do you have some disappointment from people that you have already trusted, for example?
Not, you know, there are investments where things did not go well and whatnot, but it's, you can't be disappointed because it just wasn't meant to be. Do you know what I mean? It's, you've got, as an investor, I think one of the things you've got to do is, and as an entrepreneur, is just to take a step back and say, okay, whatever is meant to be is meant to be, and you've got to kind of impose yourself when necessary, but also control your ego and step back and say, okay, it didn't work out, we're going to move on. So, you know, the whole idea of being disappointed or angry or having resentments, that it doesn't work, it's not, it doesn't help, so, you know, there's no use doing it. Okay, any more questions?
Well, if there are no more questions, I guess that we should close the session.
Thank you very much.